instead of like taking this concept of people get lucky on the internet and like being salty about it, use it as like inspiration of like, if I do show up every day, my odds of being the one who gets lucky are like increased by a bajillion.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Headliner Mindset Podcast. Today's guest is an artist and DJ that's bringing a super fun and fresh sound, vibe, and personality to the dance music scene. He's been touring all over the place, releasing on huge labels like Mad Decent, Spinnin', and Monster Cat, and getting support from the biggest artists in the game. You can catch him in the middle of the crowd at raves, giving money to people if they answer his questions correctly. This is Gesture.
Hell yeah. What's up, man? How you doing?
My man. Good to see you again,
brother.
Been
a minute.
It has. And,
yeah.
You know, we actually only really connected one time. You came in to do a Q&A at Icon Collective, which is so cool. Donating your time, your energy, your wisdom to share. And I remember when you came in, we had only just like a brief interaction to kind of hang out and chat, but we very quickly dropped in and we're talking about like personal development books and spirituality and like all this really cool, deep shit. And I was like, this guy's kind of dope. I like this guy.
Yeah, man, that's crazy. Yeah, I've always been like really open and eager to do that kind of stuff because I feel like there's this like great mystique behind being an artist. And like, I'd say now, more so than even when we first met, it's actually becoming the norm for kind of artists to be more personable online and more interactive. But when we met, which was, I guess, 2018 or 19, even, I don't know.
Yeah, probably 5 years ago.
Yeah, like it was still like DJs are cool guys with cool pictures, serious faces,
yeah.
And you don't get to like know what they're like. Like, are they normal humans or not? And yeah. I think from a very early point in my career, I always just wanted to like not be that way, you know?
Yeah.
It's kind of boring.
For sure. For sure. Well, I'm glad that you took that approach and I appreciate you taking the time to be here today.
Of course, man. Of course.
You know, it's funny. I've been having a lot of conversations about branding recently because I also work with a branding agency kind of on the side. And I've been learning a lot about branding. And one of the things that I've seen is, I don't know if you've ever seen it before, but basically these brand personality archetypes where they'll call, like Nike, for example, there is the archetype of Nike that's called a hero brand, right? They're sort of like the best of the best. They're about mastery. If you even think about DJ brands, maybe like an Armin van Buuren is like a hero brand, you know, like I'm just
right.
Like the god of trance music. There's another brand archetype that's called the everyman brand, which is more of like, it's the everyday dude. Like it's not the inaccessible hero or the inaccessible, the sage. There's all these other sort of vibes. And I think about like Fred again, you know, he's just like a normal dude. It seems like you could totally approachable. So it's cool that you kind of took that path, but I was wondering, I'm like, are you familiar with those? Or was that intentional or was your brand just sort of, did it just sort of evolve naturally like that?
Yeah, no, I'm not familiar with that concept at all, though I am really interested in the concept of archetypes more recently on my like self-development spiritual journey, kind of have been into like Carl Jung and like all that kind of stuff. So it's cool that this theme of archetypes is kind of, it's cool to hear that there's that with branding. I'd love to check that out, honestly. But yeah, no, it's something that's just natural to me. I mean, yeah, like I said, I've never been one to put on a mask or maybe, you know, frankly, maybe at the beginning of my career, I think I did try that a little bit because it's like, oh, everyone's doing that. I actually listened to this guest mix I did like maybe 2016 or 17. And the intro was like, hey, this is Gesture. And I could tell that I was putting on this like cool guy voice. I actually just listened to this yesterday, so it's kind of funny. But I was like, hey, what's up? This is Gesture. Like, so it's kind of interesting to look back at that and listen to that and be like I could see that that was naturally what I thought I should do. But I think it just kind of fell away. And the more that I leaned into just being myself or more approachable or whatever. Like, honestly, the more it led to my success. So it was really easy to continue that path because it was very rewarding for me, you know?
Yeah. Just being authentic, just being who you are.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay. I want to backstep a little bit because you talked about Carl Jung and what you're learning. So let's go down that rabbit hole for a minute, because that initially was sort of how I fell in love with you in the first place, was you are on this path of self-development and learning. So I'm curious about, what are you studying right now and what are you learning?
Honestly, it's been maybe about a year since I've been super deep on the Jung stuff, because that was more like quarantine and whatnot. But I got super deep into the whole, just that whole depth psychology stuff, like Carl Jung, and then like, God, what's his name? I can see the book. Richard Johnson, I think he like studied myth. No, I don't think it's Richard. There's Johnson.
Joseph Campbell?
Joseph Campbell is one of them, but there's another guy, Johnson, who is in the same vein. And yeah, I got super into the whole like symbolism and mythology being stories of the inner world and psychology. So that was a huge, you know, I think this stuff kind of goes in waves and cycles. You can probably agree and relate, because I know that you're also into like health and fitness, clearly. And so like for me now, I'm back on the like more practical self-development stuff of like getting my diet right and like getting like my exercise routine down better. So I kind of go back and forth where I'm working on the inner world, going to therapy a lot, doing that old stuff. And then like, you know, then kind of like, oh, I'm getting a little sick of this. Start doing this. So now I'm like doing ice baths and all, you know, getting my splits down and whatnot.
I love it, man. I've been thinking about that recently, because with Headliner Mindset, we are talking about mindset, which is your mental energy. But we also have these other areas of energy that we need to be looking at your physical energy. Are you taking care of your body? Sleep, diet, exercise, ice baths, right? And so that has to be a part of the conversation. There's also this other piece about emotional energy, right? I love to hear that you're going to therapy, because that is a lot more dealing with, not only what's happening in our head, but what's happening in our heart. And it's all connected, because I can feel that in my body. It's like I'm feeling my feelings. There is a somatic feeling side of it, right? And I would also add, you know, there's our spiritual energy too. There's this whole other thing that's sort of beyond us. And yeah, you can really focus on each of these categories, but they all interweave with each other, and they all do need to be looked at, because, you know, if one of them isn't being taken care of, it's going to affect all the other ones as well. So,
yeah. And recently, you know, I don't remember where this is from, but I came across something talking about kind of like the absence of religion and how people have like latched onto like other things as their God or religion, like even just like health or like fitness or wellness, but like in an unhealthy way, replacing a higher power with something that can't really serve as that like spiritual fulfillment. You know, like people make calories their God, where it's like they've made their spiritual life around preaching about this thing or whatever. So yeah, spirituality is really important to me, and it's all interconnected, like you said, and you brought up like sleep and diet. And honestly, like I'm at this point in my life because I felt that I needed to get better, that like making sure I'm getting the right amount of sleep. What happened with me is I got diagnosed with ADHD during quarantine. I've always kind of known I've had it, but I got serious about understanding it more and understanding how, you know, obviously I would get distracted. Obviously I would hyper-focus on projects. But I wasn't understanding that it was also causing like the like super negative side effects, like burnout, because I would be hyper focused on something so much. I would put every ounce of energy, you know, 110% of energy into something. And then I would not be able to work for the next like 2 months. Yeah. And I would be very depressed for the next 2 months, like very depressed. Yeah. And so that's been my current like 2 year journey, is just like, against all odds, how do I get better at balancing my energy? Like, frankly, it's just energy balance, and just like, I'm still not great at it. Frankly, it's a lifelong journey, I think, for everyone, but that's what currently I'm really like working on.
And especially as a DJ, as an artist who isn't necessarily living this very consistent, I would imagine not living this very consistent Monday through Friday, 9 to 5 schedule, it's a lot easier to fit things in when you know exactly what your week is going to look like every single week. A lot of other people have that privilege. I would imagine as an artist and as a DJ, your lifestyle doesn't probably look like that, right?
No, yeah, no.
How do you find that balance living on this sort of roller coaster adventure of being an artist?
Yeah, I hope I can come back in like 2 years and give a good answer to that. You know, I'm just going to be real and say, I don't know. Just like we mentioned already, just being conscious of like, I'll have this thought like, oh, I can't like do the work today. Like, I'm such a bad worker or I'm so lazy. But catching that thought and being like, wait, no, I'm a little tired. I'm just going to rest. You know, like, so I think that's step one.
Yeah.
I'm getting okay at that. I'm getting better at that. But that's been huge and just kind of giving myself that grace and being like, or like, oh, I'm not getting any work done today. And then I'm like, I shot a piece of content. I wrote an email for 40 minutes. I, you know, made two meetings in the week late. Like, so I've done like 3 hours of work, which is probably what a regular 9 to 5 person does every day, that amount of work, right? Yeah. And I've done that in the first 3 hours of my day. So giving myself grace is important for me, you know?
That's huge, man. That is one of the biggest parts of what I focus on with my coaching. I have this conversation all the time, and I start off every session with celebrating. We start off by celebrating because our brain is so trained to look at what we haven't done, where we're not yet there, we're not yet good enough. We're always searching and oftentimes just beating ourselves up, being like, yeah, I did 90%, but we're going to focus on the 10% that we didn't do. And it's very easy to make ourselves feel like shit. And one way that we have to almost like force ourselves or train ourselves to start looking at, well, what have you done? And sometimes it's just as simple as like, yo, you got out of bed today and you put your fucking pants on. Right?
Right.
But to actually acknowledge yourself for that, to recognize it, to celebrate it, whatever you focus on, you're going to feed. And we're oftentimes focusing on what we haven't done, where we haven't been perfect, where we might be falling short a little bit. And then we feed that. And it's a very dangerous slippery slope. So back to that mindset piece, man, that's like a huge fundamental 2-degree shift in a different direction, but it actually makes all of the fucking difference.
Yeah. Yeah. There's that book, The Artist's Way, which like gets at this almost like list of needs, right? I need to reread that book and start doing it, frankly, because that's like such a game changer. But there's also this book that I read called Misconnections about depression. And it just kind of like breaks down like depression is like, it comes from us not meeting these like basic needs that humans need, because this is how we developed in communities, you know, like doing certain things with a mission and all these things. So like, that's another thing that part of my finding the balance is like, have I met all my needs? Like, and like self-care obviously is really trendy and it starts with like taking a hot bath or like buying yourself something nice, but also with like the shitty things, like going to the gym, if you don't like going to the gym or whatever. And also it's like getting your social needs met, like getting those basic human needs met, getting like looking out across a landscape and like focusing your eyes into the distance and not being inside a room, you know, like that's the other thing. It's like I start to go through my needs is like, oh, I'm not getting the work done today, I suck, okay, I'm a little sleepy, or no, oh, I haven't worked out in a couple of days, or no, I haven't been outside enough in a couple of days.
Yeah,
right. So it's like that's the big thing for me right now. And that's why I've kind of put down the books in all these like deep studies. I'm just like, okay, where's like, let's meet basic needs. Let's make sure those are met, you know?
Yeah, man. And you can read all the books in the world and learn everything that's out there, but are you actually doing it? Are you embodying it? Right. And
right.
I mean, believe me, bro, I've read every fucking book. If I actually did everything that I had read, like I would be Superman, right? So sometimes you do got to put the books away and be like, all right, let me just really bring myself back to the present and the action, the execution, the practice. You know, that's where things really start to change.
Yeah. Yeah. When we met, I was definitely like it was kind of the beginning of my self-development journey. And it does feel like so perfect at the beginning where you're just like learning all these things about your brain, about yourself. And you're kind of just like, it's so easy, like kind of making all these little shifts that make a big difference at first. Right. But like you said, like I've read all the first page of self-help book and the second and maybe half of the third page. So I was like, okay, like at some point, exactly. Like let's start to just implement little things because having the knowledge doesn't mean you're executing on it.
Yeah. And so many times it's like, you just got to go back to the basics. I've definitely totally fallen off before. And, you know, it's like the runaway train is just going full steam off the rails. And then it's like, shit, why are things not working? I'm like, wait a minute. Okay. Let me get up early again, or let me start going to the gym again. Let me start eating healthy again. Let me start drinking water. It's like, okay, back to the basics. That's the foundation. If the foundation isn't there, you can have as much high level, you know, conceptual stuff as you want, but like you got to just come back to the basic needs, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's too easy. It's too easy to fall off the train. Like literally my week this week has been like, I toured a little bit. I was tired and I was feeling kind of crappy. I was like, all right, I know that I need to get my sleep better. And then I got my sleep better and I'm like, I'm still kind of low energy and feeling crappy. I'm like, oh yeah. I'm like eating like quesadillas on like low carb wraps, like,
yeah,
exclusively right now.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. I'm just full and then of I'm like, oh,
that's
right now.
That's healthy, right? Like, I'm eating like protein and low cal. No, like, okay, like, so now I just have like butternut squash on a salad, and I'm like,
attaboy,
resetting my like, I'm like, damn it, gotta do this again, you know? But like, I know when I'm through the 10 so days of like resetting, I'm gonna feel so much better.
Yeah,
so yeah, it's constant.
You got to fuel the machine, man. It's like you are, especially when you are your business. Like the whole thing revolves around you having your energy dialed in and aligned of like, what am I feeding myself? And that's not just what am I feeding myself physically and what am I eating? Yes, that goes into that physical energy container. What am I feeding myself mentally? Am I, you know, reading the books, or am I watching CNN, or just watching dumb shit, you know, tuning out, watching things? There's so much like negative garbage out there that's so addictive, just like junk food. There's like the mental consumption of mental junk food. And what kind of people am I hanging out with? Am I hanging out with people that really inspire me and lift me up? Or am I not hanging out with people at all? Or am I hanging out with people that maybe aren't like the best sort of, you know, influences to be around? And so all of that is going to affect our energy on these different levels. And if we want to be operating on all cylinders, it's really important to be paying attention to what are we consuming and interacting with on all these different levels.
Yeah. And like the idea of like, I am my business, I am my brand. That's kind of like, again, the reason that I'm coming back around to these ideas and getting myself in order, because right now in my business, in my brand, I'm really working to take it to the next level. Like, I think people assume that a career as an artist just kind of looks like, and this is like with self-development, with everything, everyone just assumes it's kind of a straight line up, or like up plateau. But there is just so much up and down. Someone told me this early in my career and I was like, yeah, whatever, but like, no, it's not for me. But yeah, you know, I'm at the point where it's like, okay, like I'm doing everything I did last year and it's all amazing. This is beyond anything I could dream of doing. But I'm doing all the same things I'm doing last year and I'm not doing kind of new things this year. And so I'm kind of like at that point in my career where I'm like, I need to be as primed as I can be, as ready to go as I can be, because I'm about to push as hard as I can on this career again. And I'm not 22 or 3 or 4 anymore. You know, like I'm 32 now and shit hurts when I drink 2 drinks and I need 2 days off, you know?
Yeah.
So like, I'm really trying to get myself, I need to feel like that 24-year-old again who just push. So, you know, that's why right now I am just getting it locked away.
I love it, man. What does the next level look like for you? At this stage in your career, what's next? What are you aiming for and pushing towards?
I was kind of having this thought earlier today, and then I was like, oh, I'm going on this podcast later. So that's a good thought to be having because I can kind of touch on it. And it's like that idea that like you think that the next level is going to be where you're happy and successful. And then you like, there is no like oh, I'm here now, so everything feels good. Like, success will never scratch the itch of validation that you're begging for from success. So like, that's a hard question to answer, because it's like, I have like the idea in my head of like what success looks like to me, but I know that when I get there, I could be having the same conversation and I'd be like, oh, I need to like push harder and get further, right?
Do you feel like you're successful right now?
Yeah, I do. But on a different day, and you ask me that, I'll say no. You know, like it's definitely tough to, or maybe I'm even just saying, yeah, I do, because I know that I should say that more so. Because because there is a part of me that's like, I'm not successful enough, or I'm not where I think I should be, I think is really the answer. So yeah, it's tough. I definitely, that's another part of this whole self-development thing, is just like being happy with how far I've come, like driving this thing basically by myself, you know? So to answer the question that was asked initially, I'm working really hard on my record label and our monthly party in LA, and trying to really grow that into like a cultural movement in dance music, because it's always been this way, but it's always kind of been like that one leading genre at the top of dance music that just kind of takes over for a certain amount of time. And what I want to do with my label is get back to the times where like it was more about like a concept of like, I think Mad Decent is always a good example, and it's what I use all the time, because there was no one genre coming out when Mad Decent was like pumping out music as a label, but it all was Mad Decent music, and they toured a block party for years off of that kind of concept, and they built, you know, Diplo built his career off of it, built so many artists' career off of that. And it gets a little boring that it can only be one genre of music per season. That's cool. So that's something I'm really working on, kind of as bigger picture thing. And then for my personal career, the next level for me is just like really honing in on, like, honestly, more from the business side, frankly, is like really honing in on consistency and like releases, and I guess just the brand as a whole. Like, I don't have a manager right now. I'm looking for a new manager to work with, mostly because I'm really good at conceptualizing things. I'm good at coming up with like these content concepts and with like musical concepts, but I tend to, like I said, hyper focus on something so much and kind of leave other things by the wayside while I'm doing that. So right now is like a reset process for me, where I'm like getting my music in order, getting my ideas in order, and then making sure that I come up with a really solid, you know, 6 month, 1 year, 5 year plan, and start kind of following that so that the execution is more consistent.
What do you think it will really take to get to that next level and to actually execute all of these ideas that you have?
Just more forethought, frankly. More planning. Less like of the, I'm an artist, I'm a creative kind of mindset. Because that's what got me to this level, and I'm happy with this level. I could live at this level for the rest of my life. But I do want more, and like, it's the same with like working out. Like, I just want to use this analogy because it feels better. But like, you can go to the gym once a week, your muscles get bigger. You can go to the gym twice a week, and then like take 2 weeks off, and like you can do all these different things and your muscles will get bigger. But if you like go to the gym 3 times a week, have a really consistent plan, you're like tracking your numbers, you're increasing your load over time, you're getting the right amount of protein, you're going to look great and you will reach the goal of being healthier, feeling better, blah, blah, blah. So as an artist, like, I can release a song, I can do cool content, I can do a cool meet and greet, but like, I'm not doing them in this like workout split way, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm not doing it in a way where it's building off of each other like efficiently. So that's what I'm aiming towards.
I love that you bring the workout analogy into it, because it's something that was kind of at the foundation of the idea for this podcast, and something I'm even doing is like my second episode, I brought in like my old CrossFit coach, because as I'd been looking at the world of artists and coaching artists, a lot of my background actually is in sports and playing rugby, and these days, you know, doing CrossFit, and it was like there is so much structure. There's coaching, there's teams, there's plans, there's workouts. And I think athletes and artists are very similar, and they're both chasing this sort of same big dream. But the world of sports actually has coaching and structure to it, whereas with artists, you're just sort of figuring this shit out by yourself, right? So that's a big...
Yeah.
I had a huge breakthrough around that, and it's actually a big foundation of why I do what I do and kind of wanting to bring this world of coaching or this methodology of coaching into the world of artists, because it doesn't really exist. But something I talk about a lot, you know, I work out, you know, 5 times a week. I love this shit. And yes, I think a lot of people are chasing the goal, right? What's the result? You know, everyone's like, dude, like, how do you get bigger? How do you get a six pack? Or how do you do this? Like, what do I need to do to get to this destination? And to be honest, like, I just fucking love the process. Like, that's my secret.
Right.
Is I actually enjoy getting up in the morning, and I love going. And I think that's oftentimes the difference between me and somebody else, or a lot of people that really struggle with trying to get their fitness there, is because they just sort of want to get to the destination. Back to what we were talking about is like, are you only going to be happy once you get there? Or are you actually going to love the process along the way and be happy along the way and be fulfilled along the way? Because when it's coming from that place, I get the result, but I'm not even chasing the result. This is just the natural, inevitable consequence of loving the process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's so real and just like so hard for especially everyone. Just like, I mean, not to be cliche, but I feel like the cell phone plays a big part in this, because like we just lack so much presence.
Yeah.
And like, even I'm not saying this as like I'm not preaching this, like I lack so much presence because I am on my cell phone a ton. And same. I need to like get back onto not being, I need to delete TikTok for a little bit, because like there's times where I'll get to the point where like my hours on my phone are racking up. Right. And then like, I'll have a time without my cell phone and I'll have like 30 thoughts that are really important to me. And I'm like, oh shit. Like I haven't let these thoughts come through for like a week, because every moment that I'm not doing something, I pick up my phone. Without that presence of like being at the gym and lifting weights and being like thinking about the weight you're contracting and like, or the muscle you're contracting, and thinking about taking the oxygen in and thinking about your body and being like, thank you, body. And like, this isn't a goal to be, have a bigger muscle. This is a goal to like overall wellness, you know, like that lack of presence in the gym is what makes you hate it. Right. Yeah. So like, same for everything else, especially as an artist, you know, like I see a lot of people who hate the idea of making content, you know, and yeah, they're just like, oh, why can't I just be an artist? Why do I have to be a influencer now too? And like, that's not it at all. Like, this would be a good thing to touch on, honestly, because it's like, we're all content creators. We're all creators. We all create something. If it's just thoughts, if it's humor, if it's food or whatever, we all are creators. We're all content creators. Mm-hmm. And like, there's people who I know are like, oh, I could never, I just can't do it, like, da, da, da. But they're like the funniest, best storyteller I know. And yeah, it's like, bro, figure out how to use that, which you love doing. You can't shut up. Like, you never shut up. So figure out how to use that skill, that gift that you have, and make it for other people online. Because that is an important part of being an artist these days, unless you're an anomaly, which those exist. But everyone has something to create and offer. And so it's just about finding like what it is that you love to do and finding a way to show that to other people.
Why do you think artists resist the content creation piece so much?
I think it's mostly fear. I think they'll say like, I signed up to make music and DJ, or for a DJ, for example, I signed up to make music and DJ and be that, like, I didn't sign up to be a content creator. So like this, like, and then there's that negative connotation of like content creators or influencers. So it's kind of like a combination of like resentment to the fact that this job is requiring more of them now. And then like additionally resenting the concept of an influencer, and like, I'm not like a girl who goes and gets a latte, and like, but like underneath all that, it's the fear of being rejected, of not being good enough, of people not getting enough likes or whatever, you know, like that's where it really comes from, I think.
Yeah, yeah. And I love that you talked about this idea that we are all creators, that we are creating all of the time, right? You're creating,
yeah.
You're creating your food, you're creating, you know, everything is a just a creative decision. We're creating our life, we're creating our relationships. And I think when, as a creator, as an artist, when you expand the perspective of seeing that this is the only place that my creativity goes, is it goes into the studio, and you take a bigger, expanded bird's eye view perspective, and it's like, no, wait a minute, the whole thing is a creative process. I'm creating my career, I'm creating my business, I'm creating my relationships with the music industry, I'm creating the content. I'm, you know, it's like all of it becomes a creative process. And I think when you can find that same excitement, you know, the same excitement that you get from creating music, when you can start putting that same kind of energy and excitement into these other areas, then it actually becomes fun. And it's like, oh shit, you start to see results. You start to see things growing. You start to actually get influence, right?
Yeah.
and people actually give a fuck about what you're doing, and they start to come to your shows, and you start to build an audience. And but you have to get over, there is that mental block of like, no, this, I'm not supposed to do that, or whatever it is, right? I see that it's the biggest block that people are stuck on.
Yeah, yeah. It's tough too, because like, it's such a quick, fast moving world of like what is cool to do online. If you're trying to do what's cool online, like it went quickly from like very produced, staged, whatever, planned things to just like being as natural and real as you can. And even it took me some time. I'm 32, like I said, like it took me some time to like grasp that, because we come from like, we saw the internet be created. So we've been through like so much of the internet. The younger generation is new here, and they're not as like we used to, like it was very formal for us to be on the internet. You know, it was like,
yeah,
sometimes it took a lot of effort to like, I had like a 100-foot telephone cable that I had to plug into the telephone jack, bring it down to yeah. the basement and like get online, you know? And yeah. so like, and then your parents and everyone growing up was like, never do this online. It's like a dangerous place or whatever, right? So it's never been like a casual, natural place in our upbringing. I had a friend who like posted something that it was like promoting music, and they planned it, and it was like this whole skit they did. And then they posted another video where they were just reacting to a song and like going like this. And that one, the second video, got more likes. And like, why the fuck would this get more likes when it's such a stupid video? And I'm like, it's because that is just you being natural and real on the internet.
Yeah.
It draws people's attention so much more. Like, they're just like watching you like a zoo almost, right? Yeah. Like,
and also back to this idea of brand personality archetypes. You know, there are some brands that are more of an art project, and there's like a story, or they're a bit more serious, but that's aligned with their brand. It's the whole thing is going to be dark and mysterious, and you're not going to see them doing some silly shit, or just even authentically being themselves, or maybe even showing their face. And that's fine. But there is something powerful to be said about when you just kind of stop giving a fuck and lean into just being yourself, it does land and it does resonate. You know, I used to manage Sullivan King very early on in his career. And that was this huge point of contention, was they're like, all right, we know we need to be on social media. We need to be out there like marketing ourselves. And I kept like pushing him like, yo, you got to be on Twitter, man. You got to be out here like sending off some tweets. And it was this whole challenging, almost calculated thing where we were watching what everybody else was doing. So he was like, well, I think this is how you're supposed to show up and what you're supposed to do. And then finally, he just was like, kind of took a couple months off, like went in his cave. We parted ways. But when he came back, he just allowed himself to just be himself and who he was, because he was trying to be this. He was kind of this like metal badass dubstep guy, but he's just right. A fucking silly goober dude. And he just came out and just started being his natural self. And he blew the fuck up. And I was like, oh, that was the missing piece, was just be yourself, because who you are is pretty dope. So stop trying to like sugarcoat it, or stop trying to manipulate it in some way, and just lean into who you already are. And it fucking works.
Right. And it's such like, I'll stress, it's like such a learning process, and it takes time. It's not like, oh, be myself online. Okay.
Yeah.
And then here I am being myself, post it, and you're going to like, it's going to go. Like, no, like that's a learning process. I'll go back to the gym real quick. Why not? It's like, if you learn the exact way to lift a weight, perfect form, you're doing it perfectly, and for 1 week you have perfect splits, perfect nutrition, perfect everything, your muscles aren't going to be bigger after 1 week. Like, yeah, it takes that consistency and showing up. Obviously, working out is like, put in energy, get back results like pretty easily, because that's just how it works. It doesn't work like that for art, but the consistency is like relative to gym life, right? Like, it'll work itself out. It just takes showing up.
And that's where I think a lot of people are stuck, is just like, you got to be willing to get in the game. You know, a metaphor I use all the time is like, get in the arena, right? Either you're on the sidelines and you're sitting there eating popcorn, watching everybody else get down and dirty in the arena, watching the gladiators fight, or you're actually in the fucking arena, right? And I think 95% of the world is just sitting on the sidelines watching other people get after their dreams. And the truth is that when you get in the arena, you know, everybody's scared of getting hurt. Like you said, fear of rejection, fear of failure, fear of looking stupid. And the truth is that when you get in the arena, it's not a matter of if you get hurt, it's just a matter of when. Because you're going to get punched, you're going to get kicked, you're going to get stabbed, you're going to get fucked up, you're going to fail. But that's part of the journey, right? So I'm always like just trying to encourage people, like, yo, be willing to get messy. I had this guy, a new client I'm working with yesterday, man. He's been sitting for 5 years. He's been sitting on his fucking music, sitting on his dream. And it finally was burning him alive, you know, eating him alive so hard that he's like, dude, like, I have to do this. Like, I need to go for it. I'm like, cool. One of the big things was he just hasn't posted anything like ever. And so literally on our call, I was like, all right, bro, get your fucking phone out and post on your story right now. Like, just get over the fear. And it was so rad because, you know, he was so scared and there was so much hesitation. And he got on his story and he was like, all right, guys, I'm just like announcing that I'm actually like making music again and I'm going to put it out and stuff. And then when he was done, he was like, dude, I just feel so fucking good. Right. Cause it wasn't even the actual thing or the action underneath it. It was just fear, hesitation. And that's going to show up in so many different areas of your life. But if you can learn how to lean into it, all of a sudden, dude, like, go do that every day for the next 30 days. You're not going to give a shit about posting anymore. And you're going to also start figuring out what actually works and what your voice is and what feels good and what people resonate with. But you're never going to figure it out unless you just start.
Yeah, I have a homie. You may be familiar with Goshfather. Do you know that guy?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I figure you guys might cross paths.
Yeah.
He's been putting out one remix a week since the start of this year. And, like, it's such a huge undertaking. And, like, some of them are getting, like, you know, some catching some steam. Some of them not so much. And, like, none of them have changed his life yet. But, like, one, he says he's just, like, loves the process. Like, it changed his perspective of producing. Where, like, we were talking about remixes and I was like, he was like, dude, did you just post that remix on Instagram and, like, only make the drop? And I was like, well, I made, like, some of the song, but, like, not the full thing. Like, oh, but, like, that's so hard sometimes because, like, when you just make the drop and no intro, it's, like, impossible to make the intro sometimes. He's like, yeah, like, I used to be like that, but not anymore, because he's been making a remix every week for half a year now. So he's like, I'm just, like, better at producing now. Like, that consistency is so game-changing, you know? It's just, like, it means the world. Like, it makes the biggest difference.
And it goes back to the process, right? When you dedicate yourself to the process, you get good.
Yeah, yeah, and exactly, yeah.
A lot of people don't know this, but that's what Zoo did. A lot of people think that Zoo came out of nowhere, like he was this big mysterious artist and he dropped Faded and then he blew up. Zoo was a kid from USC that was out grinding, hustling, playing every show he could. And I'd met him very, very early on. He did a whole campaign called 52 to Zoo. And it was the same thing. He did a track a week every single week for an entire year.
Wow.
52 to Zoo. And what happened was, you know, he had probably made 50 songs before that, 50 songs that year. He might have made another 50 songs after that. When he got discovered by his managers, the managers just, they wiped his identity off of the internet. And they're like, look, we're going to pull all this stuff down and we're going to relaunch you in this really cool, mysterious way and basically make it look like you came out of nowhere. And he dropped, you know, he dropped like one song, I think, that got premiered on BBC, and then they dropped Faded. And that literally like brought Deep House to the mainstream. And everyone's like, oh my God, this guy came out of nowhere. It's like, no, that was song number 200.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
A lot of people don't realize that, right? It's like when people look at me and they're like, damn, Nick, how'd you get the muscles? How'd you get the physique you have? Yo, I've been doing this shit since I was 15. I got fucking 22 years. You know what I mean? That's how I put in like literally my 10,000 hours. I kind of want to say there's no way around it. Like people kind of get lucky and maybe there are some ways around it, but when you just dedicate yourself to the process, cool shit's going to happen regardless.
Yeah. What's dope is that like, instead of like taking this concept of people get lucky on the internet and like being salty about it, use it as like inspiration of like, if I do show up every day, my odds of being the one who gets lucky are like increased by a bajillion, you know, like, yes, people get lucky and you could be that person. But like, if you only post once a month, like, sure, you could get lucky. But if you like buy a lottery ticket every single day, you have a lot better odds of winning.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So it's like, yeah, it's that's a huge part of it. Just like putting in the work, like showing up. It's a grind.
You do really well with creating content. I love your stuff, dude. The thing that you do when you go to raves and all right, we gotta talk about that real quick because that's my favorite shit ever. What do you call that?
Making ravers rich.
That's right. So tell the audience what you do about that, because I think it's the coolest thing in the world.
Yeah, I go out into the crowd during raves with dollar bills, heavily inspired by Billy on the Street. I'll shout him out because people think that I'm like purposefully stealing that, but I'll run up to people with a dollar and be like, for $1, name 3 genres of EDM or just kind of other EDM related trivia.
You know, the thing that I get sad about actually is you ask people, what does PLUR stand for? And it seems like it's like less than half the people actually know what the fuck PLUR stands for. And I'm like an OG raver, so it kind of breaks my heart. I'm like, come on, guys. Like, that's what this whole scene is about. But I'm blown away at how many people can't answer that fucking question.
Yeah, it's funny. Like, I've gone through this, like, mental being the creator of this content and, like, sitting back in my little lair watching the reaction is, like, I've gone through, like, the struggle of, like, seeing people get mad about certain answers or sad and being like, it's just for fun. It's just entertainment. Like, 90% of these people, first of all, when someone runs up to you and asks you a question, you go blank, like, period. Like, Billy on the Street, for example, did one where he's like, went up to a woman for $1, named 3 women. And she struggled to do that, literally. So that's the first thing. It's purposefully challenging to just even remember your name in that point. But yeah, I just struggle with it because it's like, when I post those PLUR ones, it'll be like, 2 people know it, 2 people don't, right? But all of the comments are, oh my God.
Yeah.
Scene's going to shit. And I've been doing this since 2019 now. It's been a while now. And it's funny to see people be like, The scene was so much better then. It's like, it was like this for the past 4 or 5 years. Like, it's just how it is.
I guess I'm becoming one of those bitter old fucking grandpa ravers. But
no, everyone's like that. Even the people who've been raving for 1 year, they're like, oh, it's going to shit. Like, I get it.
it's hilarious, man. I love it. And what I was going to ask is, you create so much great content. It's really fun. It's really engaging. How much time do you spend? Like, what's your balance of I'm working on music versus I'm also making content? What would you say that sort of time allocation ratio looks like for you?
God, I'm at the end or I'm paying the price of that because I do need to focus more on music, frankly, because it became really fun and exciting for me to do that content. And it's a challenging equation to master, like, what's the most important part of being an artist? And it can be a different answer for everyone, frankly. But sometimes it's been out of balance for one reason or another, where I have been spending a lot more time doing social media and content creation than working on music. And, you know, I guess I kind of, like, was, in a way, experimenting, kind of putting a hypothesis to the test of, like, if I'm getting out there enough on social media, like, how much music do I need to put out? Or like, what makes me happy as a creator? And does it also like keep this thing moving, right? So the answer is like, being out there a lot and people recognizing your name is game changing. Like, I'll be in the crowd at some things, people are like, oh, it's the guy from TikTok. Even DJs and artists that don't follow me would pretend they don't know me, kind of like that ego relationship of some artists who, like, you know, would not say hi to you or whatever. But like, then I will go up to them and ask them like a question. I started doing it with DJs more often now. and they'll like, oh, it's this guy. Like, what? You knew who I was? Like, that's kind of like, it's surprising. So there is a balance, though, because I am at a point where I'm like, oh, shit, like, I've been not releasing enough music. And that is a huge, I mean, first of all, that's the reason I do this. So music should be number one. But the name recognition that the content brings is also really rewarding and I wouldn't say important, but important for my model, you know? So long way to answer your question. I need to balance the music a lot more personally, in my opinion and in other people's opinions, but it's a delicate balance to find. Balance is the theme.
I love though that you said that you're having a lot of fun with it. Right. I think
that's
back to that point I was making before, where when you can find the joy and the fun and you can find the creative fulfillment, because also making a track every month or two tracks a month and putting out 20 songs in a year and not putting out much content to back it up with, or not really, ultimately, it's you're building your fans, you're building your audience. Like, that's what the content is for. So that's cool. You just put out 20 tracks, but you only have 7 fans. So you're probably not going that far with that either. You got to find that balance and it's going to be different for everybody.
Yeah, I mean, I think John Summit's a great example because he's just like a superstar now. And he had like a couple songs that were like doing well. Like, let me just like give you my experience of John Summit as a person consuming music, not even as a DJ. Like, oh, I saw his name come up on like a house playlist on Spotify and I liked this song. I recognized it. Going to this playlist and I'm like, oh, John Summit, cool. And then kind of like saw his name on like a lineup and I'm like, oh, good for this like guy. He's getting shows, you know, like this is my third party experience of him. And then you see him on Twitter and he's just like, everyone loves this dude's Twitter personality. Like that thing separated him on such a huge scale, even from like his contemporaries who are doing just as good music, playing just as many shows, like doing the same thing, but like that piece of him that was his personality that he put out there just like separated him in this insane way, and it made all the difference. So like without the music to back it up, without the DJ sets to back it up, that means nothing. But without that piece, that stuff would have just left him in the same level as other people, you know? So
it's all of it.
Yeah, it's everything coming together. And that's the thing is, like, success is different for everyone. Maybe like I'm like giving myself this advice, frankly, but I'll give it to you guys too. Like setting a goal of like what you're looking to accomplish in a certain time period and then like going backwards and setting the steps that it takes to get there. Like set yourself goals and like meet them. And that way, like you're not, it's not always like ambiguous, like what you're trying to accomplish, right? Like that way it's like, oh, I need to do more content. Oh, I need to do more music. And you're just kind of like frantically like trying to do them both at the same time or frantically like doing shit. When the year's gone by, like, where are you? Like, have you just kind of been twiddling your thumbs a bit? So,
you know, back to that idea of celebration, I had a huge breakthrough with a client maybe a couple of years ago where he and also I think a lot of other people have this goal of, I want to play EDC. I want to play Coachella, right? That's the goal. That's the vision. It's like, okay, cool. That might be a 5-year goal. So if that's the only goal that you're focused on and the only goal that you're excited about, well, when you spend the next year not hitting that goal and the next year after that not yet hitting that goal, you need some turbo boosters along the way to get you excited, to keep you excited. So our whole process was like, all right, cool. In order to get to that goal, what are all the other sort of milestone goals that you need to accomplish in order to get there? And let's make sure that we're celebrating every single one of those along the way so that you can feel the excitement, you can feel the progress, right? Because like if you go hit the gym for 6 months straight and you look the fucking same at the end of 6 months or at the end of 3 months, you're like, I don't see any results. You're going to get very, very discouraged.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so it's like, yo, what in the next 30 days can we accomplish to get you to taste some success? And taste a win, because yes, there is the success of these massive goals, but like bringing it back to the success of each and every day, if we can keep feeding that, that's going to be what helps us continue on our journey, because there's always a next level to get to. There's always a goal you haven't accomplished yet.
Bro, trust me, you're going to play EDC and then you're going to be like, oh, I want a better set time. And then you're going to have a better set time You're going to be like, oh, I want a better stage. And then you're going to have a better stage. And you're going to say, oh, they didn't get enough fireworks. Like, you're always going to want the next thing. And that is life in general, period.
That's the ego. That is the unquenchable thirst of the ego. And that's the little motherfucker in your head that you have to master, right? And I think it's like really coming back to gratitude. You know, I had a great conversation with Hades, good friend and an artist. And I asked her about EDC and she was like, you know, because I was like, oh my God, you just played EDC. How was it? And she was like, you know, like I just come in with like very low expectations so that when I do it, I'm really excited about it. And she's like, I'm just staying in this space of gratitude. Cause she knows, like, all right, if I get too caught up in the, like, why was I not further up on the lineup or why did I only get paid this much? It's like, it's a slippery slope and it's always going to be there. Right.
Yeah.
I'd be curious to interview, like, you know, fucking Tiesto or somebody that's like one of these huge guys and kind of see, like, what it, does it still exist at that level? You know, like, if you're human, I think it does.
Yeah, I feel like I'm gonna say no, it doesn't for them, but like it probably does, right? But like, there's a point maybe where like there's like such a big machine behind you, but also getting to that point is you have to be like a special person. Like I think like look at Diplo or whatever. I think people will be like, oh yeah, like it's not that remarkable or whatever. Like no, like he's there for a reason because he is who he is and he navigated life the way he did. Like he's Diplo on purpose. Tiesto is Tiesto on purpose. You know. I actually saw a clip from your social media about Henry Fong saying like knowing when to pivot and like, and I'll like add like knowing how to cut your losses or like not to like be too like rigid and like, this is what I do. And like, I'm not doing something else. Taking a step back and being like, why do I do this? It's the line between like doing it for the art and doing it to sustain your life and as a career. It has to be flexible, like, depending on who you are, of course. If you want to make music just for art, if you want to make any art just for art, get a job, like, for real, because you're going to hate it. You're going to fall out of love with art. If you're doing it full-time just to make art, like, so few people get by on that model, you know? And I think there was a point in my career where, I don't know, like, it's also kind of like, that projection element of like looking at people like, oh, that's corny. But like also there's like a bit of jealousy or desire to be at a place that these people are. Like, you're projecting. You're so afraid of doing that thing. You're so afraid of being in that position that you just have to like insult it, you know, in order to like be okay with not being there. So like that's a layer that you really have to unpeel. Like if you want this to be your career, you know?
Yeah, that unconscious... Like, well, I don't really even want that, you know?
Yeah. It's like, and no, that's a good content creation is a good example, I think, right?
Yeah. I don't even want to be a cheesy influencer. Like, no, so I'm going to just stay right here where I am, where it's like, all right, let's peel that layer back and deep down. Yeah. Where does that often stem from is probably some jealousy, right?
Yeah. And just like projection of like, I was funny one time in first grade and I got in trouble for it. And like, that's just like beaten into my brain. Like, don't try to be funny or whatever. And that's why therapy is super important, right? Like, that's why mindfulness and presence is super important so that you're actually thinking about those things as well.
Yeah. And I want to circle back to where this entire conversation started and we'll close the loop where... We had talked about our love for personal development and some of the books that we were reading when we first met. So as some final words of wisdom, what, let's say, two or three books would you recommend to people to read that you think would really help on their journey?
The first book that like just like blew my mind and pushed me into this, which is like one of those books that everyone knows, The Power of Now by Eckhart Tolle. Like that one is just like helps you to understand the concept of mindfulness on like a deeper level than like beyond spirituality almost, even though it is very spirituality book, but it's just kind of like, it's almost just like, duh. Like I think this isn't from The Power of Now. It's from A New Earth or A New World by Eckhart Tolle. But he says something about how like when you have a stomach ache and your stomach hurts, you're not like, ah, my stomach sucks so much. Like, fuck my stomach, you know? So like when you're like experiencing depression or anxiety or whatever, and we're just like, oh, I suck so much. Like this brain and the stomach are organs in your body. So like figuring out how to like zoom out and like remember that you aren't your brain, you aren't your thoughts, super important. Another book that is similarly spiritual but different is called The Spontaneous Fulfillment of Desire by Deepak Chopra. That one is really good because it's like, it's about manifestation, but it starts off with like Schrodinger's box, and like it starts off kind of with science and how just like, what's it called? Quantum mechanics and quantum physics, how like as above, so below, like at the smallest level, when we observe something, we kind of turn it into a wave or a particle, right? And like that is the same, you zoom out all the way. So like your thoughts really do kind of dictate the direction that your life goes.
Yeah, I dove in deep into the idea of manifestation when I interviewed Freddie Lane a couple weeks ago. And that's a really, really cool conversation. And I think, honestly, is a fundamental piece of, you know, how I teach and coach and work on people with, because it's real. And that's the cool stuff is when you see like metaphysics, it's like not just some woo-woo spiritual shit. There's like science behind it, right?
I think like it's so important to like, I think people see spirituality, even like manifestation, for example, and like you can very easily roll your eyes at it and be like, oh, like, yeah, magic. But like magic, like this is all magic, bro. Like,
yeah.
This is magic. So like learning how to control magic, that's like Harry Potter can do magic, but he goes to school to learn how to control magic. Like that's what we're all trying to do. Like success is learning how to control your magic. Your magic being the thing that brings you to the gym, even if you don't want to, like the magic being the thing that's like creating cool songs or cool content. So like magic is real, but it's not like hocus pocus. It's not make something levitate. It's control over this force that animates us.
Yeah. And I always say like, yo, you don't have to really understand it, but try it out. Try it out and see if it works. You don't have to believe in it. You don't even have to understand it. Try it out and see if it works. Like when I walk into the room, I don't know how fucking electricity works, but I flip that switch on and I use the light. Just try it out. See if it works. If it doesn't, whatever, let it go. But like, try shit out.
Our thoughts fucking create our reality. That's for sure. If you don't, you're not loving yourself. Every time you have a moment and you remember, just say, I love myself. I love myself. I love myself. Say it over and over. You don't have to believe it at first, but like you say it enough, you're just like, oh yeah, like I do love myself, you know, like it is that simple.
I love myself. I love you too. I appreciate you taking the time to jump on with me today. I had a whole list of questions and thoughts and ideas that I had written out, and I didn't look at that shit one time whole conversation, and I loved every minute of it. But, you know, thank you so much, man, for coming on, and I'm really excited to, you know, see you step into that next chapter and that next level and all these great things that you have coming up. So definitely stay in touch and keep up the great work.
Yeah, great to reconnect, man. I wanna